أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم since some weeks we are discussing some ayat of the Quran pertaining to the promise that Quran will take and in fact it took at that time from the darkness to the age of enlightenment. And under this caption, we had selected a group of 7 ayat which contain this promise. And within that group, we are discussing only those ayat, in fact, some of those ayat which pertain to family matters, particularly marriage and related matters. And last time, we had discussed some best practices or successful models in the world. Today, inshallah, we are going to discuss part 2 of the successful models which we discussed last time. I may clarify one thing here that, and you must have observed during all my lectures, during all these years, I have been not talking about any particular philosophy of any philosopher or any school or even my own philosophy. I just pick up a point or a topic or a word from the Quran. I try to study that, research into that. And when I come to a certain opinion about that matter, then I try to clarify it further, support it further, elaborate it further with the help of history, philosophy, science. It's not like we are doing generally that we see something, some discovery is made and we say, oh, this isn't the Quran. My starting point is Quran, and then when I verify with other sciences, I again come back to the Quran, to the root of the word, to everything in the Quran, in the context and everything, to reconcile with the opinion which was formed, and then supported by these sciences, they are all in harmony, and then I place it before you. And then still I make one request, that this is a book for humanity, for all mankind. And it is our responsibility to study it ourselves. So I request to kindly conduct your own research, study it yourself, and then you can form your own opinion. I'm not even insisting on any opinion. It's up to you to kindly conduct your own research. I'm simply trying to facilitate and provide some information on that. This ayat of the Quran, Ar-Rijal Qawwamoon ala Nisa, Surah An-Nisa, ayat 34, it is one of the most misunderstood ayat in the Quran. And people speaking against this ayat most of the time, particularly we modern people, when we don't understand it, that why men should be the protectors of women, why they are the managers or administrators or wali of the women. This is the translation. This is not my translation. And here I'm not talking about translations. I am not, and you have seen that I am not giving the translation of the Quran. I'm just trying to give the wisdom in the Quran. And this ayat has remained very controversial so far as translations we have produced. The main reason behind opposing or misunderstanding these ayat, which we don't study properly, is the main reason. One is our own inferiority complex before other advanced cultures or advanced civilizations. And since we are in the decaying state, so we have inferiority complex. I'm talking in plain terms, and also because of the ignorance, particularly ignorance of the Quran, this combined, it has an impact on our personalities, in our culture, on our society. It has influenced our polity, our political conduct towards law or towards its implementation, and all other collective matters, administrative matters, and our community conduct, our social psychology has also been affected. And we now show off modernity in a deliberate attempt to speak against the ayat, to oppose the ayat. For example, we had discussed the ayat about inheritance, and we say that why there are two shares for a woman and one share for why the share for the woman is half of the share of the man. Actually, we have not been able to implement it properly in the light of the dictum of Quran. That is why there are problems and there is injustice with the women, and they also, without going into the ayat itself, they also think that it is because of the ayat, it is not because of the implementation, it is not because of the behavior of the man himself or the society himself which we need to change. There is great injustice, and under this ayat also, since great injustice is being done to the women, we think that the provision of the law is bad. So let us see what is the position. I'm trying to influence your mind right in the beginning. I leave it to you, and then you kindly at the end you conclude yourself what is the position. I'll try to discuss it with reference to some advanced model of some advanced economy, advanced country, advanced culture, advanced civilization in the world, in the present world. And in this connection, I tried, first of all, to find in the Muslim world, if I can find a developed country with based human development index, with based socioeconomic indicators, where these ayat, this legal system of Quran is being implemented. And I'm very sorry to say, and I'm very ashamed to say, that there is none. And that is why our women are suffering, our society is suffering, our children are suffering, and our own society, total society is suffering. Then I looked at the developed world. I found some examples there, some very near, some resembling, but I have found one model which I will discuss with you from their perspective, not from the perspective of Quran, from their perspective. And then you see whether we can correlate any of their achievements in the light of Quran or not. Now this happened, this came to my mind first time, and you must be aware, this is during our lifetimes, that during 60s and 70s, there was a lot of upheaval in the world. Student agitation, labor agitation, lot of movements were ongoing. During that period, in 71 exactly, I was conciliator. There is a department in every government, in every department, there's a ministry. It deals with labor and employer conciliation under the law. It is under the law. I was the conciliator, I was appointed, and I was a conciliator and working in the legal department in 1971, a very young man. At that time, I came to know, and then I studied, found books on that, that Japan was least affected even at that time by those movements. And why? I wanted to understand that. I went deeper into that. One of the reasons was identified as the employer-employee relations. That is why there was lesser labor problem or agitation. In the early 20th century, they had during, say, beginning years, that is 1906 or 1907, there are a lot of problem. And I'm talking of 70s. Because the reason was that they emulate their family model in their industrial relations. And this point led me to go into this aspect. And after 50 years, when I was preparing for this subject, I tried to find out some literature on that. And I was surprised that still today, after half a century, the research in the world, the statistics show that, yes, it is the family behind the Industrial Revolution of Japan, the industrial development of Japan, the modernity of Japan, the advancement of Japan. Employment and labor relations, I'm quoting here, and I've given the reference also. This says, the success of corporations in Japan is attributable to the remarkable motivation of the workers. And this comes from the family. Our topic is family, family relations. And here, the main focus is Ar-Rijal Qawamun Al-Nisar. Men are the administrators, managers. They are responsible for the protection of rights of women. They are responsible. They will be asked. In some lectures, we'll discuss that. That men will be asked that why this injustice took place with the women. Workers have a strong sense of loyalty and identification with their employers, and this comes from the family. This, the basis is in their family system. Britannica, Encyclopedia Britannica, you kindly go there. I've given the reference and find it there. Britannica is not written today. It's a very old book. Japanese culture places a high value on family relations and obligations, and some analysts claim that the family model carries over into the workplace. And we feel inferior that if we take our model of family based on Quran, and how can we take it? Yes, we are not able to take it today. But it is not the problem, it is not the defect in the Quran or in the prescription. Defect is with us, and you will, I hope, inshallah, see that how we are responsible for that. And I have given this into inverted commas, as it is, I have taken the, it's only copy-paste. Employers are expected to show the same regard for their workers as a parent shows for other family members. But how it comes? Kindly, I am giving more references here. The book I read at that time, our books, references I read at that time, I couldn't find those. I've forgotten whatever I had, the books maybe in my old library. But this book I found here, Family Structure and Industrialization in Japan, particularly written on this subject. And at this time, I propose to place these slides along with the references. Allah on the YouTube, brother Anis, he told me that and he can do that. So I'll make a request to him. I'll forward these slides also to him, that if it is possible for him, he has been doing extra effort every time to serialize and place all these things on YouTube. I must appreciate him. I'm very thankful to him. Allah bless him. Another reference, family in Japan. Another reference, husband and wife living in nuclear steam family households in Japan. What is the steam family? I'll discuss that. The structure of the Japanese family. This is very important. Structure. Quran has also given a structure. Then nuptiality in Meiji Japan. At the time when a survey was taken, had been done. I've shown that survey also. And this also at the on Wikipedia, you can find references, so many references. There are different articles on Wikipedia, not one. There are different. Historical, I'm talking of historical, natural family, not the family as defined in the law, the legal family. Today is defined in some countries. We'll discuss that also. Historical natural family model serves the objective of having children This is the objective of the marriage. This is the objective of the family. Today we are marrying without any objective of having children. They will come through surrogacy. Without having family, we don't need family. But this is the natural, historical, humanity's process of having children and building family on the pillars of a natural mother, not surrogate. On the pillars of natural mother and natural father. In my book, Surrogacy, right in the beginning, I have given the findings of the Supreme Courts of the world, some Supreme Courts of the world, and then some other scholars, that who is a natural mother? The gestational mother. Who bears the pain? Who gives the viladat? And Quran has defined that. Who is the walda? Who is the walid? Everything has been defined. Natural mother and natural father. The basic constructing block of civilization. A natural block in the natural process of building civilization. Natural family is smallest management unit of human beings. We had discussed last time. One of the philosophy behind having monogynous family instead of four wives or multiple wives is a concept to deal with certain situations as a relaxation, as an exemption. It is not the basic historical or natural form. It is not the norm. That is an exemption. We are talking about the norm, which is normal. Natural form family is smallest management unit of husband and wife, a husband and a wife. Necessary for preservation of both genders, not one gender. As there is preference for gender selection in some countries and some people, or they mutilate the gender after the child is born, or even after the person grows in, as an adult, they are mutilating themselves. Development of culture, this is also one of the objectives of a natural family. Man is cultural, man is social. In a natural environment he was placed. And he is a natural environment. And attainment of civilization. What is it's not just development of civilization, it is attainment of civilization to reach the apex. Civilization is the advanced stage of human living. In 1970s, in United States, in Europe, in other countries, liberalization of sexual mores and consequently lifestyles diversified. Particularly when in this period it intensified at the expense of concept of family. Concept of family. A broader range of cohabitation types. There are different types of cohabitation, man and man and woman, woman and woman. And there are so many cohabitation types appeared as the gender based because why it appeared mainly, what is the factor behind that? The factor behind is the gender based division of labor, responsibilities of father and mother was no longer the predominant format. We lost that. We said, no. There's no labor division, man and woman, same doing, same job, same thing, equality, equalization, everything is equal and they will be equally working for all jobs. But the priority that we are the manufacturers of human beings, we are producing human beings in our own factories, Harsun, Arham, that was lost. This division of labor force was lost. More countries in the West today are recognizing same-sex marriages in contrast to the frame of natural family. Now, natural family is not the objective of marriage. It is not the objective of building any culture or civilization. The same-sex model needs support of It needs artificial support because it is artificial. It is not natural. It needs support of invasive surrogacy technology. It is supporting it. Otherwise, this cannot go further. Today, if a man is wanting, there are two men in wedlock and they want a child, they are looking for a surrogacy. There's a surrogate mother, some surrogate, and adoption rubrics. These rules about adoption are still in this field, are still in the infancy, just starting, just we are learning like a child. And by the time the child learns without any guidance, without any divine guidance, as in the beginning it was, and we still have available, we might despise it, and we have already despised a lot. Overly expanding from personal attitudes, kindly give this attention, personal attitudes and affiliations of court systems. The decisions are becoming binding, taken by one person, not by the parliament. Look at the era, the laws. There is a plethora of laws, bills I mean, pending in the parliaments. The laws are not made, positive laws are not made. But how this liberalization is taking place? All this liberalization is taking place under interpretation. 14th Amendment, First Amendment, Second Amendment, and so on. And the interpretation of an individual, or a group, or two persons, or three persons, or jury, a number of a small group of people interpreting, not taking, no debate is taking place in the parliaments. And these laws are becoming binding. Priority has shifted from building family to merely finding a partner with mutual fondness. Profane love. Instead of founding a family, it is mutual fondness instead of founding a family, in which economic shortfalls are then naturally to be covered through double income arrangements. They both have to work. Each earning for himself. Even here, when the people come for counseling, I think 2 weeks back when the couple came, the problem was, what was the problem? The husband and wife, they're sharing rent, and the husband couldn't pay the part of his rent for 2 months, and the dispute came, flared up to the extent that they want to separate. The husband failed to share his rent. And then there are others also, but there are other cases also, the husband not paying rent for 10 months, for 1 year, for 2 years. There are, and a husband or wife does not contributing rent to the rent. And then the husband says she is not contributing to the rent. There are multiple number of cases, such cases taking place. Many more women had to become part of labor force. Man was already working. The woman was made to work because she has to earn. Now she has to share the rent. She has to share everything. Children outside wedlock in this new system and divorce became more acceptable. It is acceptable to the society. It is acceptable to the law. It is acceptable to the court. Increasingly, it is acceptable. After World War II, after occupation forces brought new family concept in Japan, we are talking now of Japan, based on equality for women, yes, very good, and equal inheritance, as people suggest us, last time we discussed. They say equal women, equality for women and equal inheritance. Kindly don't think that I'm talking against these things. No, I'm not against these things. But kindly see what is the position in some developed countries and then you make your own mind. Equal inheritance by all children. Independent Japan, when it became independent, occupied forces left, established again by collective capitalism not individual capitalism, which stems from its economic and own social restructuring following World War II, after World War. And this piece is also, I've given a reference. Look at Japan. Although it didn't go for this formula, which was administered to them, not only suggested to them, it was administered to them. But they went back. They took a step back. They went into their culture, into their history. And let us see, did they make any progress if they went back into their culture? Today, if you look at the GDP, look at the unemployment rate, only 2.9%. Inflation rate, minus 0.6%. And Japan is one of the countries where for a long time the riba has been zero. There's no riba. No usury. The economy of Japan is highly developed and market economy. Third largest in the world, so far as nominal GDP is concerned. Fourth largest with the purchasing power in the world. And world's second largest developed economy. Now, with all this progress, how is it possible that the divorce rate went down? We have seen that in the developed countries with development, with these models of development, social and cultural slogans, their divorce rate has gone up. And here the divorce rate is only 0.13%, 0.1. What is the position in other countries? Comparably, 70s, 90s, 2012, all the way increasing in all these developed countries, even going up to more than 50%, about 60% divorce rate, 60%. And Japan is 2.2. It was less, 1.1, but now in 2012 it has increased, and it is increasing. But the rate of increase, the incremental rate, is also low. But look at 60%, about 60% and 2%. Compare that. The people who went back. Now look at these sources. Again, I have given a quotation, simply copy and paste. I'm not taking any credit. What are the strengths of Japanese family model? It's not sufficient to say that they went back into culture and they built the family system and they built the industrial system. It needs deeper study. What are the strengths? This is the strength. They are not Muslims. They don't know about this ayat. The ayat which I show in the beginning, I've shown in the beginning. Men are the protectors of women, protectors of the rights of the women. They are responsible. There will be questions on the day. They will be questioned on the day of judgment that why you were unjust to the women that you suffered all along in your life also. Why didn't you spend on them? Why did you make them to work? Why they had to earn their own bread? And this ayat, as I said last time also, one of the most misunderstood ayat, most and shamefully interpreted. Women are the sarmaya. They are the capital, human capital. And with this capital, whatever society you want to build, come to them gently, deal with them gently, handle them gently, behave with them gently. And whatever you want to build, you build with that. Anna Shaitan, what do you want? Let us see what other people want. They have been doing. Well, we'll come to that also. Keep that in mind. Anna Shaitan. Now, Arham is singular. Womb. The word womb has been taken from this root. Arham is singular and Arham is plural. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that be conscious of Allah and be conscious of Arham, the relations of the blood. Be conscious, be careful. Two things together mentioned. Wattakullah wal Arham. The mother's womb is called Rahim. Why? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that when you are in the arham, in these 3D printers, human 3D printers, I design you. At that time, I am designing you. Don't misbehave at that time. Don't interfere with my process. Huwallazi yusabbirukum fil arham kaifa yashaa, as he wants to do that. Don't interfere in that process. God 3D prints living beings in merciful molds. This is the meaning of arham, the merciful mold of the mother. Sabyusabirkum, the designing is taking place, manufacturing is taking place, 3D printing is ongoing. And what do you want at that time? Align your objective with the objective of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He wants to produce as Adam was the proud production of the universe, and he proudly presented to the entire creatures, creation of the world, of the universe. Let it be produced like that. Let it be 3D printed like that. Anna Shetam. How do you want to produce it? Family roles at that time. Last time we have discussed this. Family roles, behavior of mother, behavior of father, behavior of the family impacts the 3D printing of human beings. Fabrication of genome along with intelligence and emotions. It is not a dead 3D printing of concrete or any steel. It is 3D printing along with intelligence and emotions. So our conduct, which is interfering, any conduct which you feel is can interfere with the emotions of the woman at that time, it bound to impact that. Last time there was a question that how it can impact mother's body, that there may be a cleft lip, there may be some defect in the manufacturing, but it is quite, it has been proved, it has been shown, and I had shown these studies, and I again went back and saw some more studies that how it affects the child, the baby, the fetus, the embryo. The embryo or the fetus or the child is not disconnected. It is all the time in connection with mother's heartbeat, with mother's emotions. If mother is suffering emotionally, her blood pressure is affected. Her every cell of the body is affected. And the blood flow is affected. And at that time, any slightest thing can interfere. If the intensity of that interference goes up, crosses certain limits, it can interfere in different ways to create different defects. What you want, Anna Shaitum. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking what you want, whatever you want. He's giving option. I'm making this baby at that time. What you want, how you want, would the baby be, you would like it to be made. Make some observations, there are some observations and quoted, discussed. What do you want? Some observation, there are some observations. If you ask the German mother or German people, the German mother raises children for German nation. This is the objective. Even of suffering two world wars, complete destruction, the nation is again leading. This is because the mothers are producing children for a German nation. This is the focus, family. And then Napoleon demanded good mothers to raise good nation. If a survey is conducted honestly, we conduct our own surveys in underdeveloped countries. Mostly what we find is most probable answers are, when you ask the people who are women or family, then why are you raising the children? they would be raising children for bread earning, for poverty, ignorance. We are raising the children so that tomorrow they grow up and they earn bread for the family. This is a pathetic situation. Some might name some professions, say middle class family, they say my son will become a doctor, my daughter will become an official or a doctor or something like that. This is the aim of the mothers. And there are still other people, very pious people, very good people. If you ask them, why are you raising your children? He would say that I want to raise them as religious persons, religious people, very good, religious. But at the back of the mind is what they mean by that. If I say I want to bring my child as a good religious person, at the back of my mind is not a good Muslim, a good Sunni Muslim, a good Shia Muslim, a good Wahhabi Muslim, a good Sufi Muslim. This is at the back. We are creating sects, strengthening sects. And that is how the society breeds bigotry and zealotry right from the beginning. We want to bring up the zealots and the bigots. Until around third quarter of last century, families with a gender-based division of labor were norm in the world, in Japan also. In most industrial countries, including Japan, such arrangements were favored and many couples built their families on this model. I'm going slowly as compared to my presentations usually in the past, and I want to emphasize every word here. Strong gender roles still remain cornerstone of family responsibilities in Japan. Even after industrialization, gender roles, strong gender roles, father's role and mother's role, you can distinguish. Traditional gender roles, this is in fact the topic also, Japan gender roles. Traditional gender roles, what happens in that, men as income earners and women as homemakers. If I say this statement in the interpretation of an ayah, people will fight with me. But when I am quoting from Japan's existing practical, today existing situation, where the traditional, according to the traditional gender roles, men are the income earners and women are the homemakers generally, normally, in majority. Overwhelmingly, child care is regarded in Japan, in spite of all this progress, child care is regarded mostly as the mother's specialty. Nobody can replace it in the animal world, mother's care. The father's domestic role is limited in this respect. They accept it culturally, socially. Full-time working wives have the burden of housekeeping also. But if they are working by choice, at the same time, they have still not abandoned this speciality, this responsibility. It is in fact an additional burden on their shoulders, but they are discharging this duty. And generally without help. And how did they generate this help? That we'll also see. Mothers help daughters because there is a close society, there is a supportive culture is now helping. Mothers help daughters who need help in child care and housekeeping. Joint family system. We don't need inheritance system of Islam because it is encouraging joint family system. You will see this as we go further. Working mothers prefer living close to their mother's house for this reason. These are the results of the surveys actually happening on ground. Daughters live near their mothers. Mothers live near their daughters. But what about the paternal side? That we'll also see. Wives have a lot of authority in their household. men have given almost all liberty in these matters. They are the decision makers mostly. Men are in fact working as if advisors. Mutually they are consulting. In urban families, husbands as bread earners have lesser time with children. This is an unfortunate thing. But it is whatever has come in the survey. A housewife may be working also by choice or by some other compulsions, yet with nearly total responsibility for raising children. To raise the children is the responsibility, whether we say or not, is the speciality of women. This is Japan happening. Ensuring their careers, their marriages, running household and managing family budget. But this is not all. There are some strange things taking place, happening there, very strange. Importance of family in Japanese society, what is the importance? Why this importance? Family is very important because the society, Japanese society, is not individualistic. They are not thinking for us and them separately. It is a collective society, collective capitalism, new term they invented. They are not individualistic. Family is an entity whose purpose is more important as a family collectively than personal fondness. Even if there is natural fondness in a couple, somebody likes some boy likes some girl, or some girl likes a boy, but they adjust themselves within the interests of the family. They don't give precedence to their fondness to the family foundation. This is the difference, the great difference. Japanese have heightened sense of belonging. These are the findings. Japanese have heightened sense of belonging and loyalty to the family in a collective society, even collective capitalism. Family members are expected to serve family's interests before individuals, before individual fondness, and accommodate fellow members. Brother accommodates brother. Sister accommodates sister. If one of them is poor, they support him. Generally, Japanese parents are totally devoted to the success of the children. This is the motive, this is the basis. If in some societies, they are marrying only because of fondness, not with the objective of having family or children, then why should have they this objective? But the situation is different there. They are marrying because of the founding a family. If I explain this thing with reference to the concept of asbatan and umman in Quran, people will not. They will they will go against me. But these are the words, these are the findings of Japan, not mine. Families also have a collective face in Japan. They care for their family reputation, for the name of the father, Abu Bakr. I am son of Abu Bakr. They care for the name of their parents. They care for the name of their family. They have a collective face. If the society loses this, then anybody can become a criminal because he is not so much worried about himself. The criminal is not so much worried about himself. The act of a single individual impacts the perception of one's family name in the society. And there are mentioned, there's mention in the Quran, there is collective responsibility in the concept of qisas, restorative justice. Now United Nations is working on restorative justice, but we don't know whether it is qisas, based on qisas, idea of qisas. These ideas are being picked up by others. Look at this ayat. How the qawm is formed, how the nation is formed. In most surveys, people indicated that family life should emphasize parent-child ties, even more than the husband-wife relations. This is their priority. And I'll show you what are the other findings of these surveys. Japanese couples regard parental role as mother and father as more important than couple roles as husband and wife. Father and mother role of a father and mother versus role of a husband and wife. They don't give up, they don't discard it, but the priority is parental role. They will make sacrifices. They will adjust for the children. Here, the women are coming. They say that I don't care for the child. I want divorce. The society will take care of the child. There will be their social security. I don't care for the child. I want divorce. They devised a new term. Domestic divorce. We have heard about domestic violence, but not about domestic divorce. It is different from zihar in Islam. It is zihar. In Quran, it has been mentioned, it is abhorred. It is not like, it is bad. That here, domestic divorce term was coined. Because when the parents are sacrificing, making many sacrifices, not to separate, just to cling to the unit, for the sake of children, this is the situation for which this term was created. It has been found that people with the industrialization, the couples have little time to converse. And this is one of the reasons where the communication breaks, the separation starts. And then when this situation crops up, then a situation of domestic divorce comes in. It is a situation of divorce, but because of the children, they adjust themselves. In spite of that, yet in many cases in Japan, they do not divorce with the mutual consideration for the children. They continue. These are the surveys, reports, findings. Is there a joint family? Connected through inheritance. I'm emphasizing connected through inheritance. I discussed inheritance last time. It is not a booty. It is not a loot that the son takes away and the sisters are suffering. Mother is suffering. No. They are suffering not because of the dictum of Quran. They are suffering because of our own conduct, misbehavior, injustice which we are doing to them, wrong implementation. Two generation nuclear family, they call it a nuclear family because they developed this model after they were destroyed by the atom bomb, after Second World War, after they got independence. I've shown that they were given the model of equality, but they came back to their culture. So the model they developed after nuclear impact and destruction, it consists of parents and their unmarried children. They live together. A joint family system is still continuing there. But this is not sufficient to describe the joint family system of Japan. There are wonders in their society. Two generation single parent households. There's a single mother and a child, or a single father and a child, as here. There is a major, overwhelming number of people, a single mother and child, single father and child. But in Japan, for example, an unmarried, divorced or widowed mother and her children, or a widowed grandmother and her widowed daughter are not common. There may be mother and child, but they are living with their mother. There may be a single father and child, they are living with their family, with their parents. There is a joint family system still strong, even after these things are happening. It's still common in Japan, but rare in other advanced countries, are 3, 4, and sometimes even 5-generation households. Grandparents. Grandchildren living together in one family in spite of problems of spaces. These are not my findings. These are findings of the others. statisticians, scientists. Usually one child from family may live with grandmothers in the natal home. They are attached to their natal home. One of their child must live in the natal home. One of the child will live with the grandmother if she is alone. If she can't be accommodated in the same house, if there are some other problems, but grandmother, grandfather will not be left alone. One of the child from the family will permanently live with her or him. It is a symbol of intergenerational continuity. Continuity, and continuity is maintained through inheritance also. I'll come to that. I'll show that under the law of Japan. Of esteem family, Shajara, Arab side Shajara, esteem family, continuing from founding ancestor Abu Bakr to living members of the family, continuity. Are they tribal? No, they are not tribal. They are a modern society. In all respects, they are a modern society. I've been to Japan, I've lived there. Stay with the families and you find the difference. This is another reference. All along in Japan, Japanese history, all family members have been expected to contribute to the perpetuation of the family, not the breaking of the family. Son running away from parents, leaving them alone at old age. People living separately, husband, parents, mother and father, living separately after retirement. This is not conceivable there. Although the trends are changing, but still in 21st century, this is not happening at a large scale, or even at a scale which can be noted. Perpetuation of the family, which is held to be the highest duty of the member of the family, highest duty of the son, particularly, to hold the family, to keep the family intact. Now recall our discussion on inheritance. In the Japanese family, the idea of family genealogy, Shajaratan, does not mean relationships based on mere blood, consanguinity. Not only arham, not only consanguinity, not merely blood, but inheritance and succession. It is based on inheritance and succession, this continuity, the perpetuation, they call it perpetuation. And it is in the law. I'll show you, it is in the law. But rather a bond of relationship inherent in the maintenance and continuance of family as an institution. The son maintains his mother in her old age as in an institutional responsibility to continue the family name, to continue the family, to perpetuate the family, to discharge the responsibility under inheritance and under succession. We have separated this. We have left everything of loot to the son, and he takes everything. Nothing for the parents. Is it a defect in the dictum of Quran or in the design of our implementation? Succession in Japanese family does not simply mean inheritance of the deceased property. Let the father die and I take everything. Inheritance of property itself has a distinctive meaning which reflects the institutional demands of the family for perpetuation, for maintenance, for continuance. Succession in Japanese means succession to responsibility, not succession to the property. As I had discussed in that ayat when we discussed it. To succession to responsibility of family, headship. Headship means responsibility as wali. Succession to the responsibility of family, waliship, wali. And this is a Japanese term from the law, to attain and maintain continuation of family as an institution. I'm emphasizing every word separately so that we can inculcate this in our minds. The philosophy of inheritance of Islam if I explain it from that point of view, people will may not agree with me, because we have presented a very misplaced model, wrong model. Inheritance is not a booty or a loot or a plunder on the death of the father. Inheritance is transfer of assets or resources from the deceased to the survivor son, for example, to be able to discharge his duties and fulfill the responsibilities in place of his father. Kindly read Quran with the philosophy. Philosophy of Quran itself. What is the philosophy of inheritance? What is the philosophy of Quran? We have shut that part of hikmat. Depending upon his, her position on the ladder of the responsibilities. If he was the nearest, he has a bigger share because he has bigger responsibilities and he's bound to discharge. The legal system should be that if he doesn't, he doesn't get anything. And this is the Japanese legal system. As member of the family, to attain and maintain continuation of family as an institution where the mother, the widowed sister, the sister or other relations, near relations, blood relations, they live in harmony, peace, and they have a comfortable life in after the death of the breadwinner. Shares are indicative, I had submitted. According to the extent of rights and responsibilities of the family on the basis of gender, indicative. But actual distribution is according to the eligibility and the actual exercise of rights and actual performance of responsibilities of the members of the family. If the son is not discharging responsibilities towards the parents, he is not entitled to inheritance. No share. Word tarak has been used for inheritance. Tarakna, what is tarak? Tarka. We say tarka is inheritance. Whatever he inherits is his loot, his plunder. No. What is the meaning of taraka? That is why I emphasize, go to the root of the word, word of Quran. Understand Quran from its own word. Look at this ayat and its interpretation from four dictionaries are taken. And we have perpetuated. How this word has been used, tarakna, perpetuation. Japanese law uses the word perpetuation. But this is Lane's lexicon written much earlier. And these dictionaries, Jalalain, J-E-L means Jalalain. What is tarka? To make it strong. This is being transferred to the son. To make him strong, to face the new responsibilities. And one says of any action that has come at last, now this responsibility is devolved on him. He has to discharge these responsibilities. What is family? It is just a personal fondness, but it has a personal and social function. Functional family. It is a functional family. It is not a family in which the husband and wife are divided. They don't talk to each other. One couple told me they have not touched each other for 25 years. It is a functional family. If I explain it from Quran, people will not perhaps be so convinced. I'm telling you from the Japanese model. The family as an institution, they recognize, has both a social and personal function. Social function also. When we discard the functional, personal, social function, first we discard the parents. Let us see how it is happening there. Subhana rabbika rabbil izzat amma yasifun wa salamun alal mursaleen walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.
اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه. اللهم اهدنا فيمن هديت وعافنا فيمن عافيت وتولنا فيمن توليت وبارك اللهم لنا فيما أعطيت وقنا واصرف عنا شر وما قضيت فإنك يا ربنا تقضي بالحق ولا يقضى عليك. تباركت ربنا وتعاليت ولك الحمد على ما قضيت نستغفرك ربنا ونتوب إليك اللهم ادخلنا برحمتك في عبادك الصالحين اللهم اخرجنا من ظلمات الجهل والوهم إلى نور العلم اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما اللهم اجعلنا ممن يستمعون القول فيتبعون أحسنه اللهم اكفنا بحلالك عن حرامك وبطاعتك عن معصيتك وفضلك عن من سواك اللهم بفضلك ورحمتك على كلمة الحق والدين اللهم انصر الإسلام وعز المسلمين يا أكرم الأكرمين Oh Allah, spread your mercy upon us, shower us with your blessings, increase our knowledge, grant us forgiveness, and reward us with the company of the prophets in the Firdaus al-A'la. Oh Allah, forgive our parents and all our friends and relatives who have passed away. Grant them your mercy. Make their graves garden from heaven and grant them the Firdaus al-A'la. Oh Allah, remedy our sick. Remedy our son Ma'arad, brother Munshi, mother-in-law, and all our friends and relatives. Grant them full and speedy recovery. Oh Allah, guide our children, protect them, and make them righteous. Oh Allah, we ask with every name you have lifted for yourself that none of us leave this gathering, but his pains have been relieved, his worries have been removed, his debts have been paid, his weaknesses have been concealed, his sins have been forgiven, and his needs have been fulfilled. سبحان الله وبحمده عدد خلقه ورضا نفسه وزينة عرشه ومداد كلماته سبحان الله وبحمده عدد خلقه ورضا نفسه وزينة عرشه ومداد كلماته سبحان الله وبحمده عدد خلقه ورضا نفسه وزينة عرشه ومداد كلماته والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على خير المرسلين اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه والسلام عليكم